We absolutely loved Project Nim. How did you hear about the story?
Well, it came to me via the producer of Man on Wire, who came across a biography of Nim, which again is an extraordinary idea. Someone, Elizabeth Hess, a writer, had written this life story of a chimpanzee, which is very well documented in, because he lived with us for all of his life. So I read the book and I was just gripped by the surprising twists and turns of his life story. And the life story is also a very good genre. It has a beginning, a middle, and end. You're given that in a life story. It's a biopic. So I thought it would be interesting to see whether you could actually use a film biography to tell the story of an animal's life. And the life itself was so surprising and unusual that I felt you could get away with this.
Was there enough past footage? Was that a thing, an angle you had to consider?
Well, going into any kind of project, the ones I make anyway, that's an important consideration, is what are your raw materials? Because I can construct films from events that have already taken place, essentially, and try and find dramatic shape to them. But I suspected on this one that because Nim was a part of an experiment, and that experiment was documented, and you know, it was all, that there would be quite a lot of, you know, photographs and an archive, and indeed there was, but what we hadn't foreseen was how much archive existed beyond that experiment when he went to other different places and different people were involved with him.
Was everyone that you contacted happy to be involved, or did it take a bit of persuading?
One or two people needed to be persuaded and to kind of build a sort of trust between, as you try and do anyway with interviews. But it seems that there was, I think, some people had quite a lot of guilt about what went on in some aspects of the project and Nim's life, and a guilty mind wants to confess, I guess. So some of the interviews are very confessional, and everyone we approached eventually decided that they wanted to be in the film.
Okay.
So I think we did get, you know, a spectacular set of first-hand accounts of Nim's life from the people who were really there and really saw and really felt for Nim.
Professor Herb comes across as a bit of a bad guy. Was that intentional, or is it just...
Well, he's very straightforward. I mean, I presented to him certain, you know, kind of... observation other people had about it, the way he conducted the experiment. He's very, very forthright in his response, that he stands by what he did and how he did it. I wouldn't call him a bad guy or a villain. I think he had quite noble scientific intentions. But I think there was a kind of human collateral damage which he wasn't particularly aware of, both from his conduct, indeed, and the chimpanzee's conduct. There's a character in the film, as you know, called Bob Ingersoll, who meets Nim when he's around five, and Nim is an adolescent chimp at the time. They have this very extraordinary... rich relationship where they sort of gamble in the meadows together. They also like to drink beer and smoke pot together. And Nim is, throughout his life, is, you know, when he gets his hands on weed, he wants to smoke it. Mm. And if people are smoking joints around him, he knows how to ask for them because he uses the signs. That's how Bob finds out he wants to smoke a joint, is because Nim signs to him, you know, stone smoke now, Nim. So that's a relationship that with Nim that seems successful because Bob tries to meet him halfway. The rest of the experiment's about trying to bring Nim to be like us, and Bob says, actually, no, let's meet halfway here, and that works pretty well. And they have a very rich communication between the two of them for that reason, I think. Nim appears to be a smart chimpanzee, and he was chosen for that reason, that his parents were smart, that he was really smart. But he does seem to be pretty bright for a chimpanzee, but he's archetypal. He's not a genius chimpanzee, he's just a kind of regular smart chimpanzee, and shows his intelligence in ways that are way more surprising than learning language, let's put it that way. And the way he uses language is much more interesting than just asking for stuff. He deceives us with language. We give him the tools to deceive us, essentially, at certain points in the story.
And have you been to see The Rise of the Planet of the Apes
at
all?
Not yet, no. I keep hearing about it from people like you, actually.
Yeah, because
I should go and see it.
You copied Nim.
Or vice versa, yeah.
Yeah.
No, I'm very intrigued. It's been released on the same day our film is, so you can check them both out.
Okay,
and
great.
See which one you prefer. Maybe one will inform the other somehow.